You can increase the storage in two ways, by modifying what parameters? The first one, which is Cmax, obviously, this is an obvious choice. And the second, which is beta. Beta now is 1, it's linear. But let's try to increase Cmax first. When you change the parameter values, you have to be careful not to change many of them at the same time, because otherwise you can't recollect what's happening. So let's try to do this. And then I get this simulation. And then let me try to put the observer data up to it. And you see that there is already an improvement. Let's try to put it to 300 or 400. Let's make an extreme. And then the observations. And you see we are getting quite close. Now let's try to change beta. I don't remember whether beta I should increase it or decrease it in order to increase storage. I think I have to decrease it. Let me try to make an attempt. So let me try with beta 0.5. And yeah, I think, let me see, I'm not sure I decreased it much. Yeah, I decreased the storage. And now we are at a stage where, be careful, what happens here? It happens that in some cases you have overestimation of the simulation with respect to overestimation of the peaks by the simulation, and in some cases underestimation. This becomes a little bit troubling because you know, when you have a consistent overestimation of peaks, consistent underestimation of low flows, then it's easy to understand how to change the parameters. In this case, it becomes a little bit complicated. If I had to make the next guess, I don't know. Let's try maybe changing the beta value instead of 0.5. Let's try with 2. Let's see what happens, but, you know, let's see. Now we got back to a consistent overestimation, and let's then increase Cmax. Let me see. We are still overestimating, but I think this may be the right way to follow, to increase beta, not sure. But at this stage, as I said, it becomes a little bit complicated. One more thing that we could do is to see what happens if I change the value. Yeah, it's really difficult. Let me see. Of one of the two constant, I think it became smoother. Yeah, you see that we are getting close. We are really getting close now. But then, at this stage, if we want to really improve, we need to pass to automatic calibration. So let's make together this further step, automatic calibration, which is extremely interesting because it gives us the opportunity to learn a lot of more things about R. Okay, so let's move back to the code. Here is our code, and how to compute an objective function. Let's use least squares, and I think it is very easy. Let's use this instruction. It's equal to qt minus q os squared. Sorry, sum. And then let's write at this stage a return sum. So let's try to.
Isn't it a return sum?
A return sum means please give me back to the R console the value of the sum of squares. And you can put here several variables. And I am just interested in the sum of squares. How to put several variables is not trivial. And it's something that we need to discuss at a later stage. So let me go back to the R window. And first of all, I need to source the new and then let me repeat the last one simulation. Sorry. Sum, there is something wrong in the function sum. I go back. No, it was here, sorry. Yeah. Did you see that? Indeed I was mistaken in the right room. Okay. So let me go back to R and then source it. And let's try. Okay, you see that I got the sum of squares back. I got back the plot and the sum of squares. Actually, I'm not sure I got back the plot. Let me check. Ah, yeah, sorry. There is a mistake here. Not a mistake, just any plot instruction. Return should be the last instruction of the function. So let me go back to R, source it again, and then I should get the graph. Here it is. Perfect. I get the graph and the sum of squares. And now I have to use a function, a routine, to minimize the sum of squares. I told you that there are automatic procedures for minimizing an objective function. These automatic procedures are already embedded in several packages. They are embedded in MATLAB, they are embedded in R, they are embedded in Excel. Keep in mind that these automatic procedures were, up to 10 years ago, considered to be part of the background of the engineer. So devising an algorithm, looking for the minimum, or the maximum, looking for the optimal value of a function, was considered to be a task for the engineers. Up to 10 years ago, when I taught water resources management, I used to teach how to write these optimization algorithms. Then, in the past 10-15 years, this subject, which is a interdisciplinary subject. Function optimization is a task that is helpful not only in hydrology and hydraulics, it's helpful in several branches of science. And therefore, this task became part of the research activity of electronic engineers and people working on informatics. And therefore, they developed the very efficient algorithms, many of them. Different in structure, different in performances, precision, computational time, And they made these algorithms, available, these code algorithms, sorry, can't pronounce it, available for several packages. So a relevant question that we have now, it's not how to write the algorithm, but rather what algorithm should we use? And again, there are these codes have different performances. So let's, how can I select it? And this is a relevant question. Of course, I have a suggestion to give you. But how I also would like to discuss with you, in general, when we have such a task, how can we solve it? And so let's look on the web. Let me open a new window, a new web window, and let's Google for optimization R project. Okay, and here you see the first link. Let's go to the first link. It's a CRAN link. CRAN is the official repository of several open source programs, including R. So let's click on it because it's reliable. And optimization infrastructure packages. There is a description. I expect to see a list. And and you see that there are several alternatives. So Optim, it's a first alternative. Should be already embedded in R. Let's check. Here it is. It's a function that, by looking at it, it seems that it gives the option of using different methods, and also gives the option to provide constraints, upper and lower boundaries. You see that there are options lower and upper. And in this case, the default values are infinity, minus infinity plus infinity. And I mean, it could be what we are looking for. But let's complete the list. Let's have a look at the list. So basically, there is also, you see, there are other alternatives, which are NLMinB, NLM, Optimize. Let's see Optimize. Yeah, there is indeed a function for it. And but if we move forward, we have several additional packages, NL OPTR. But pay attention, these are part of a separate list. Why is that? Because these packages that you see starting from the second bullet point, they are not already embedded in R. They are packages that are available on the web, but you have to upload them in R. So there is this package NLOPTER, and then Alabama, RSOLNB, and then NLC Optim, CLU, DF Optim, and several others. GNUD. And then you see a lot of others. And now the question is how to, what to use? This is a relevant question because also these packages are continuously changing and therefore additional alternatives become available. Some of them are no more maintained. And therefore this is indeed a relevant question, what to use? Basically, I tested many of them. They use different methods for optimization. Some of them are faster, some others are slow. Some others are more precise, some others are more robust, which means that they are less precise but never completely wrong. They have different features, and after testing many of them, I gained the convincement that a good compromise, because it's quite fast, is this DE Optim. So I propose to use this one. You see that if you click on it, there is a reference manual, everything. But the first question is, how can upload it in R? And I'm sure that you are concerned by this, because you are thinking of complicated procedures. Actually, it's not complicated. When packages are listed in the CRAN repository, to upload them in R, it's very simple. And the only thing that you need to know is the name of the package. In this case, it's DE Optim. So let's move back to R then, and learn how to upload it. The instruction is install that packages. And then you need to open the parentheses and put the name of the package. Then let's try to give the return function. And it tells me, please select a CRAN mirror. And this is the list of the mirrors where you can get the package. Usually I take the closer one, which is Austria, but it doesn't make a big difference, because today the network is fast, even if you select an Australian mirror. So you give the OK, and then you need to give it some time. Of course, the wireless, the computer must be connected. Don't understand. Okay, you see that it's working, downloaded, and now it's installing. Okay, good. But we installed the package, but the package is not yet available. Why is that? Because R makes a difference between installing a package and make the package ready to use. Because R doesn't want to upload any package. It wants to upload only the packages that are helpful to us. This is because they want to save computer resources in order to keep the computer fast. So, once an installed package is needed, we need to give this instruction, library, and then the name of the package. Yeah, now it's ready. Keep in mind that these instructions can be embedded into the startup instructions of R. If you want that anytime you start R, you upload some packages automatically, there is the possibility to give to R a list of startup instructions. So library DEOptim could be converted to a startup instruction if you want. Otherwise, anytime that you start R, you need to upload the library. But now the DEOptim is available. If you make a call for the help, you see that it's there. And basically, what are the arguments of the DEOptim? A function, which is fine, because in our case the function is ready. It's the IMOD function. And then I have to give lower and upper. Good, let's try. Keep in mind that DEOptim gives back a result which includes many things. Among the many things, there are the parameter values. So let's assign the result to a variable. DEOptim of what? IMOD. And then we have to give lower and upper. And be careful, we already identified parameter values that were close to be fine. So when we give the boundaries, let's give boundaries that are not too far from our initial guess. Because if you widen the ranges for the parameters, the procedure becomes slower. So let's get back to the optimal values that I found already. I'm going back in my R window, let's see. No, I can't find it. So in order to find these values, I have to look at the history. So let me look at the history. Okay, here are the parameter values, so let me take it. I copy it, and then let me go back here. Okay, but these are the lower values, so let's put 100 here, and here it's 2, this is beta, let's put 0.1, and this is alpha, let's put 0.1, and this is these are the two cases. So the lower value, I think I need to add a couple of zeros here and a couple of zeros here. Okay, and then upper equal. So let's give 1,000, and I think 2 for beta is fine. For alpha, we can use 0.9, and here 0.1, and here again, oh, sorry. I did Ctrl C, and I went out. So basically, without any option to save. So this is why I tell you, you should save once in a while. So let me copy this. Don't ask me why I did Ctrl C. Ctrl Z I did, not Ctrl C. So now I need to source. No, the history was saved, indeed. The history was saved, so I think. I think I can. It should work, let's try. So what are we expecting now? The optimization algorithm will take a trial value for the parameter vector and will start running the function iMode. While it runs the function iMode, I expect that a graph appears and then the optimization algorithm moves forward by learning from any previous trial and converging slowly to the optimal parameter values. And therefore, I expect that at each iteration the graph changes. So let's see what happens then. Okay, there is a parenthesis missing. Yeah, he is correct. I need to do this. You see that it's optimizing. This is a sequence of trials. But let's stop it, because we cannot have any control on what's going on besides the graph. So let me stop it, because I also want to see the sum of squares, to see if the sum of squares is slowly decreasing. So let me go back to the function, and let me do this. Cut sum sq fill equal true, which is a new line. So in this way, the sum of squares is printed on the screen at each iteration. Now I go back to R and I start again the optimization routine. But first of all, I need to source the program because I made changes. And then let me start the optimization routine. And now I should see the graph, which is, let me see what happened. Let me go out from the program because there is something that I don't understand. Still, there is this graphic window that doesn't close, which is something that I don't like, but anyway, let me try again. Okay, library. So let me go back because I think that there is something wrong here. Let me see. It seems that it's missing the observed data. So let me, I think it saved the history, but not the database. So I need to upload. Okay, let me upload the data. Sorry for that, it was the closure, the unwanted closure of the program that caused this. So let me start again. You see that now we see the sum of squares there. So what we expect is it's a slow convergence. Still, this is not sustainable for us, given that the course must take care of sustainability. This is not sustainable because in order to converge, the package may require some 1,000 iterations, and it's too slow. Indeed, it seems that, let's see. It seems that it is slowly decreasing, but we are about around 1.5 million in the lowest value. Let's see, because the package once in a while gives us some summary of the computations that it did so far. You see that some of the simulations are clearly not reliable, but some of them are fine. Let's wait a little bit, because let's wait for the first summary. You see that we got some simulation already with the sum of squares that is lower than 1 million. In order to speed the process up, we should remove the plot instruction and we should remove the printout on the screen because they take a lot of time. It will become about 10 times faster if we removed these two instructions. try to wait a little bit. There are options in any optimization algorithm. There are options to define the precision, the tolerance of the algorithm. And one way to get a faster response is to increase the tolerance. I never did it with the Optim, but for sure there are some opportunities. Okay, so let's stop here. And you see that in the first iteration, it reports to us the best value of the iteration, and the best value is about 740, and the best values for the parameters. And let's copy these best values for the parameters. Copy, and let's try to run iMod for these parameter values in order to get the result for this simulation. So let's put commas here. Okay, this is the sum of square, which is correct, 740,000. Let's see the simulation. I don't understand what it is. Just one sec. I think it is this one. But because I have a R window that is still open that I cannot close, so let's put it here. Here it is. This is the best simulation that we got. Let me put lines QoS over it. Here we are. You see that it's a pretty good simulation. And this is just the result of the first iteration. Let's now try to remove the plotting functions, or we may ask the program to print out on the screen and on the plot every, not an iteration, but every like 20 iteration in order to speed it up. So let's go back to the code and modify it. And basically, the two instructions are these two. So let's do like that. Let's do in this way. If let's define a variable that is called, we need to define it here at the beginning of the program, ii equals 0. So I define at the beginning of the program a value ii. A value, variable, sorry. And then let's go at the end of the program. And we are here. Let me think how to do it, because it calls the function every time. It's not easy. This is indeed not easy, just let me think how to... Hmm. Okay. You know, there is, it's a bit of complicated because any time that you get into a function, variables are reset. And but still, inside the function, I can use. Okay, let me remove. We don't need to assign a function here. Let's do like that. And let's design the variable in R, II equals 0. Okay. And now let's get into the function. And let's do like this. The problem is that if I set a variable here, then it's... okay, so let me... I need to teach you one additional instruction, and let's see if I remember it. Assign II level no, pos equals 0. Let me try this function here. And what does this mean? It means that II is a variable that is defined into the main database of R. What is available in the main? In the main set of R variables, it's also available into the